Hi, I'm Bob Forney. I want to talk to you a little bit about this COVID epidemic that we're in the midst of. I've spent my life working with death. I'm the chief toxicologist here at the coroner's office. We serve 21 counties in Northwest Ohio and Southeastern Michigan. This is historic. This pandemic has not happened in my lifetime. And around the world, you know, people are being infected, they're hospitalized, they're dying. But the question is about the government and how much government control should we be comfortable with. Churches in Kansas, Mississippi, and Tennessee have filed lawsuits in federal court, and lawyers for a church in Louisville, Kentucky have also filed a restraining order against a mayor that is not permitting them to even do a drive-in worship service. So the First Amendment guarantees freedom of religion, and this is being tested, and many are questioning that. So that's what I'd like to talk to you about for just a few minutes. I see two issues in this discussion. The first is, should we submit to the government mandates during this pandemic? And secondly, we should have faith and not fear and love our neighbors and each other. And I say this, and I'll talk more about that in a minute, because many are so afraid that they're actually going beyond common sense in terms of our social distancing. So first then, I want to talk about our relationship to the government. Okay, so there's thousands sick, millions have lost their jobs, the stock market's crashed, many of us are frustrated, fearful, angry, lonely, want to know when this is going to end, want to know where is God in all of this. There's actually two extremes. In one extreme, some blame the government for an overreach. Others praise the government for the protection and the cash that's being provided. Some blame those who are not staying at home or wearing masks and think that they're doing something very dangerous. Others praise the protesters who are standing up to the government and violating the government mandates. This has especially been seen in Michigan recently. But we must have faith and submit. Peter writes, and we have to say that Peter was writing at a time of persecution of Christians and of the church. He said this in 1 Peter chapter 2, "Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as the one in authority or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. For such is the will of God, that by doing right you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Act as free men and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as bond slaves of God. Honor all people. Love the brotherhood. Fear God, honor the king." So this is pretty strong during an age of Christian persecution. Peter's saying, do whatever we do, it's for the Lord's sake. Let me repeat that. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution. So our submitment to government, even when government seems to be wrong, is for the Lord's sake, and he's commanding that we do that. We obey magistrates, that means people in government, in the Lord's name, not in the name of the government or those politicians. Their authority is from God. And we can do this happily and with full faith because we know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. So we should happily obey and submit, even when we think it's unreasonable. But one might say, didn't Peter and John disobey? In Acts 4, we read, "And when they had summoned them," that is Peter and John, "they commanded them," that is the ruling Jews, the Sanhedrin, "commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to give heed to you rather than to God, you be the judge. For we cannot stop speaking about what we have seen and heard." So the issue there was speaking about Jesus, the resurrection, and the gospel. It was not submitting to a government in a public health crisis. There are powerful examples of submission to governing authorities. Jesus said, and this is very familiar, we know this, this is in Mark 12, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's." And they were amazed at him. You know, the disciples hated Rome. They hated the ruling authorities. And so when Jesus says that they are to render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, talking about taxes, but actually not being a rebel against government, they were amazed. So Jesus said to Peter in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Peter pulled out his sword, he said to him, "Put your sword back in its place, for all those who take up the sword shall perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels?" So Jesus is telling Peter not to rebel against the governing authorities, but to submit to it. And again, the same night before Pilate, he's silent. Jesus is silent. And then he speaks. And listen, John 19. "So Pilate said to him, 'You do not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and I have authority to crucify you?' Jesus answered, 'You would have no authority over me unless it had been given you from above.'" And so the authorities in government are given to us by God. These are all authorities. And the Apostle Paul writes in Romans 13, "Every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those which exist are established by God. For rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior, but for evil. Do you want to have no fear of authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For it," that is these authorities, "for it is a minister of God to you for good." It is a minister of God to you for good. So God wants us to do this. Both Jesus and Paul submitted. Paul writing in Romans, Jesus, as we read in the Gospels, even though the authorities were putting them to death. And so anarchy results when there is no honor and foolishness. It is foolish to think that we can know better than those God has placed over us, even though we lack their knowledge and experience. And the fact that many are not Christians is no excuse, because Christian or not, they are authorities put over us by God. You remember in Judges, it was said that in those days there was no king in Israel. Every man did what was right in his own eyes. Brothers and sisters, we live in an age where people go on Facebook and they read something and they think they know more than governing authorities. It bugs me. You know, I had 12 years of college. And since then, I've had 45 years of experience, and I listen to people tell me things about drugs. For example, whether marijuana is dangerous or not. And it's because we've all become an authority. So when there's no king in Israel, when there's no authority that we're submitting to, then everyone does what is right in his own eyes, and this is not God's will. So Paul first exhorts us in Romans 13 to honor, quote, the governing authorities. But then immediately after that, beginning in verse 8, he adds that we are to owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. So it's very interesting, this honoring the governing authorities and loving one another are actually paired together by the Lord. So the second thing I want to talk about is this love. That's our duty to have faith, not fear, and to love God and our neighbor. You know that the great commandments, Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." On these two commandments depend the whole law and prophets. So, in other words, these are foundational principles, our love of God and our love of the brothers. So we can't allow this COVID epidemic to prevent us from loving each other. Now, we are to obey the governing authorities, and we are to maintain distance and do other things because it's not loving if we infect each other. But we can't let our fear be so great that we withdraw from society we really need to look for ways that we can do this. Jesus said in Matthew 25, "Truly I say to you, the extent you did it to one of these brothers of mine, even the least of them, you did it to me." And so when we love each other and our neighbors, we're doing it to Jesus. John writes in his first epistle, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we all ought to love one another. We love because he first loved us." And God does love us. In Romans, "What shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, who's against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things?" Meditate on that truth. God has given us his Son. How will he not give us with him all things? One of my favorite passages that I think is something that we should maybe write it out, maybe memorize it, meditate on it. Those of you who are afraid during this period. Isaiah chapter 43, "But now thus says the Lord your Creator, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I have given Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in your place, since you are precious in my sight." Since you are precious in my sight. Do you know that you are precious in God's sight? Since you are honored and I love you. Wow, we're honored. See, God honors us by giving us his Spirit. "And I love you. I will give other men in your place and other peoples in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you." So in conclusion, our duty as children of God is to honor those God has placed over us and to love our neighbor. When we honor our parents, our elders, and even our magistrates, we honor God who has placed them over us, and we do it for his sake. When we love our neighbor, we are loving our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because he said that we were. Let us therefore remain calm and sober-minded, trust God, obey the magistrates, obey the elders, and reach out and love each other and our neighbors. Thank you very much. May the Lord bless you and keep you.